Do you know what I love? I love really dumb tech. And this is prime really dumb tech. This is a website hosted on a disposable vape. Now, if I reload it, it's gonna take quite a bit of time to load because, you know, it's not exactly the fastest of hardware. This image will load one day, probably about 2 minutes from now. So here is the version over on GitHub.io, so we don't have to wait that long. And look, if something has a computer in it, then you can almost guarantee that someone is going to do something dumb with it. They're either going to play Doom with it, which I know people are working on doing, or it's going to be something like this. For a couple of years now, I have been collecting disposable vapes from friends and family, which is certainly a hobby to have. Initially, I only salvaged the batteries for future projects. It's not hoarding, I promise, definitely not. But recently disposable vapes have gotten more advanced. I wouldn't want to be the lawyer who one day will have to argue how a device with a USB-C and a rechargeable battery and also a microprocessor can be classified as disposable. Thankfully, I don't plan on pursuing law anytime soon. I don't either. Good luck, whoever has to fight that case. Last year, I was tearing apart some of these fancier pacifiers for adults when I noticed something that caught my eye. Instead of the expected black blob of goo hiding some ASIC and application-specific integrated circuit, basically a circuit made for a specific purpose and nothing else, for example, there are ASICs for doing Bitcoin mining, I see a little integrated circuit inscribed Puya. I don't blame you, this name doesn't excite you as much as it does me. Most people have never heard of them. They are most well known for their flash chips, but I first came across them after reading Jay Carlson's blog post about the cheapest flash microcontroller you can buy. They are quite capable little ARM Cortex M0 Plus micros. If you want to read that blog post, I'll leave this one linked in the description down below. And in moderate quantities, they could be had for about 10 cents a piece. Now, obviously, you're not spending 10 cents to get them, you're buying them in bulk, but there's a clear reason why a lot of these disposable vapes are using this 10 cent microcontroller. It's a 10 cent microcontroller. Now, somebody else noted that this is present in a vape as well. There is absolutely no world where something like this should be a disposable product. It's literally a cheap, tiny computer that produces smoke. How is this disposable? Over the past year, I've collected quite a few of these Pi32 based vapes, all of them from different models of vape from the same manufacturer. Now, the author doesn't list out specifically what vape that comes from, but the Reddit post over here did instead. This is from a disposable vape known as Beast Mode. This, at the time, could be had for around about $33 Canadian, which is a bit more than the 10 cent microcontroller. So if you just want the 10 cent microcontroller, there are better ways to get them. But if you happen to find one of these lying in the trash, for example, hey, there's a microcontroller you can snag in there. The chip is marked Puya C64TF15, which wasn't very helpful because this isn't actually a real product. I was pretty sure it was a Pi32 F002A, but after poking around with Pi OCD, I noticed the flash was 24K and we have 3K of RAM. The extra flash meant it was more likely a Pi32 F002B, which is actually a very different chip. However, it is a somewhat, not great, but somewhat competent chip, especially for the price. So a 24 megahertz Cortex M0 Plus, a grand total of 24 kilobytes of flash storage and 3 kilobytes of static RAM and then a bunch of other nonsense the author doesn't care about. If you're curious, I'll leave a link to the datasheet in the description down below. Feel free to give this a read if, I don't know, you've got time to read 58 pages of engineering datasheets. But I do want to talk about it being a 24 megahertz Cortex M010. Just for context on the range of performance we can expect from this. Now, obviously, megahertz is not a one-to-one direction of performance, obviously. For anyone, I don't care. I know this, you know this, we all know this. But just for fun, the Intel 8386 from 1985 was 12 to 40 megahertz. You may look at those specs and think, that's not much to work with. I don't blame you. A 10-year-old phone can barely load Google, and this is about 100 times slower. I, on the other hand, see a blazingly fast web server. Now, we have different definitions of blazingly fast. It's surprisingly fast. A lot faster than I think most of you would expect. But I don't know if blazing, unless this is a joke, unless this is a ha-ha funny vape joke. It's a funny vape joke, isn't it? It went over my head, didn't it? I think it did. I'm an idiot. It's fine. Don't worry about it. I'm not cutting this section. The idea of hosting a web server on a vape didn't come to me instantly. In fact, I have been playing around with them for a while, but after running my post on semi-hosting, the penny dropped. I'll leave this one linked down below as well. If you don't feel like reading the article, semi-hosting is basically syscalls for embedded ARM controllers. You throw some values and pointers into some registers and call a breakpoint instruction. An attached debugger interprets the values in the registers and performs certain actions. Most people just use this to get some logs because that's the normal thing you would use it for. But they're actually bi-directional, so you can use these breakpoints to send data back and forth. Now, should you do this? Well, I'm sure there's some sensible debug reasons to do so. Should you host a web server like this? No. But that doesn't stop them doing it anyway. If you're older than me, you might remember a time before Wi-Fi and Ethernet, the dark ages, when you had to use dial-up modems to get online. You might also know that the ghosts of those modems still linger all around us. Almost all USB serial devices actually emulate those modems. A 56K modem is just a 57600 baud serial device. Data between some of these modems was transmitted using a protocol called SLIP, Serial Line Internet Protocol. This may not come as a surprise, but Linux, and also some tweaking macOS, supports SLIP. The SLattach utility, which you probably have available on your system, if you don't, it's probably going to be in your repos, can make any dev TTY send and receive IP packets. All we have to do is put the data down the wire in the right format and provide a virtual TTY. This is actually easier than you might imagine. PyOCD can forward all semi-hosting through a telnet port, then we use SOCAT to link the port to a virtual TTY. I believe this should be available on most systems as well. SOCAT is a command line based utility that establishes two bidirectional byte streams and transfers data between them. Because the streams can be constructed from a large set of different types of data sinks and sources, and because lots of address options may be applied to the streams, SOCAT can be used for many different purposes. One of those is whatever we have here. Okay, so we have a modem, but that's hardly a web server. To actually talk TCP/IP, we need an IP stack. There are many choices, but I went with UIP because it's pretty small, doesn't require an RTOS that is a real-time operating system, and it's easy to port to other platforms. It also helpfully comes with a very minimal HTTP server example. After porting the SLIP code to use semi-hosting, I had a working web server. Half of the time. As with most optimized libraries, UIP was designed for 8 and 16-bit machines, which rarely have memory alignment requirements. On ARM, however, if you dereference a U16 pointer, you better hope that address is even, or you'll get an exception. The UIP checksum assumed U16 alignment, but the script that creates the file system didn't. I actually decided to modify a bit of the structure of the file system to make it a bit more portable. This was my first time working with Perl. Why is it that so many times that I see someone doing some really dumb project, oh, it's my first time using Perl, it's my first time using C, it's my first time using Rust. What is up with all of these people that say, yeah, I'm gonna learn a language just with the dumbest idea I could possibly have? But now that it works, It needs to be fast. And fast it was not. So, remember that thing about it working half the time? Well, initially, it wasn't very fast. Pings took 1.5 seconds with 50% packet loss. A simple page load took 20 seconds. That's so bad, it's actually funny, and I kind of wanted to leave it there. However, the problem was actually between the seat and the steering wheel the whole time. The first implementation read and wrote a single character at a time, which had a massive overhead associated with it. I previously benchmarked summer hosting on this device and was getting approximately 20 kilobytes per second, but UIP's slipped implementation was designed for very low memory devices, so as serializing the data byte by byte. We have a whole whopping 3 kilobytes of RAM to play with, so added a ring buffer to cache reads from the host and feed them into the slipped poll function. I also split writes in batches to allow for escaping. Now, this is what I call blazingly fast. Pings take 20 milliseconds, no packet loss, and a full page load in about 160 milliseconds. This was using almost all of the RAM, but I could also dial down the size of the buffer to have more than enough headroom to run other tasks. The project repo has everything set to a nice balance between latency and RAM usage. As you may have noticed, we have just under 20 kilobytes, 80% of storage space. This may not be enough to ship all of React, but as you can see, it is more than enough to host a simple HTML web page, an entire blog like this. Now, is it an optimal way to do it? No. Should you do it? No. But there's also the code available for the repo here, and if you want to do that, you can go and do that. Now, if when you watch this video, you notice that the website does not work, that wouldn't be the first time this has happened. The last time that somebody talked about this, the site was also killed. So there is a very high possibility that when this video comes out and people try to go to the website, it will die. So keep that in mind, and the GitHub.io page we link down below as well if you'd prefer to read that. And you know what? If any of you have done some really dumb project like this, please let me know about it. And if you've written a blog post about it, please send it to me. I love to see dumb things like this. Is there any real functional reason for it? No. But you know what I want to encourage? I want to encourage people to just do fun things. Not everything in tech has to be hyper-optimized. Oh my god, how do I make money from this thing? Am I doing something useful with my time? No, stop. You don't have to do that. If you just want to go and make a vape into a web server, do that. That's awesome. Please, more of this, more fun tech. But what do you think? Let me know your thoughts down below. If you liked the video, go like the video, go subscribe as well. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Dali Baripay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and why? Just why?